audience. Loveline may contain sexually oriented content. Content. Listener discretion is advised.
3, 2, 1, go!
Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
Loveline, coast to coast.
It is Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. It's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Fax number 310-854-4455. Dr. Drew is a board-certified physician and addiction medicine specialist. And tonight we have a couple of gold medalists, which I don't think we've had on this show, at least since I've been here. Do they have anything under bronze? Because that would be what our normal guests would be on this show. Dain Blanton and Eric Fonoimoana.
You got it.
Yeah. Enjoy it, because I'll screw it up as the night wears on. These guys won the gold in Sydney in the beach volleyball two-manner, and you guys, if anyone watched the Olympics or even has a newspaper, I'm sure they know what I'm talking about. And I watched this, and it was a pretty big upset, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was a huge upset. The Brazilians had kind of dominated the last 2-3 years on the world circuit, and the team we actually ended up playing in the finals we had never beat, but we brought out one of our best games ever and took home the gold.
Had you played them more than once? Do you see them on the international circuit?
They do fairly well. We probably played them 4 times, and they beat us 4 times.
Oh, so, really?
It's just a matter of... But when we did play them, they didn't kill us. It was more like we played a 15,
right?
Win by 2, and they beat us 15-12 probably 3 times. Maybe we lost 15-13 another time.
Did beach volleyball originate in the United States?
I think it did. I think on the beaches of Southern California where it was first played. But nowadays, it's worldwide, and every other country has caught up to us, and it's very competitive now.
It seems, and by the way, can't we do that with soccer?
Catch up?
You know what I mean?
No.
Like, every time I say to somebody, we have the best athletes in the world, why aren't we winning in soccer? And people go, oh, they've been playing for years over there, and we've only been playing for 30. And I go, okay, but that seems like enough. And they go, no, it's got to take a couple hundred years before we can get up to that point. But beach volleyball is something that wasn't played internationally very much, except for the last, how many years do you think? I mean, they've caught up pretty fast.
Yeah, probably the past 20 years, but it's a different game than we play here on the States. There's different rules, and Dane and I just abide by them. But as far as soccer goes, I think our best athletes go into, like, baseball and, the big money, basketball and football. And
that's what Drew...
So that kind of just trickles down in a sense.
That's what Drew always says when I complain to him about this. But then I always think about it. That's why we always complain about foreign drivers here. You know what I mean? We've been driving for years. Our grandparents drove. You know what I mean? These guys came over from somewhere in China. Their grandparents drove rickshaws. And, of course, we can't expect just a first or second generation motorist to keep up.
Quite an enlightened view of the world.
I think about this when I drive.
No doubt you do. I shouldn't
be angry at my brother, because the reason this guy's a horrible driver is the reason we get our ass kicked in soccer.
Right.
Yeah. But not in volleyball. These foreigners catch up fast, but thank God we brought home the gold. And what are the beach... since when has beach volleyball been an Olympic sport? It's very new, isn't it?
Well, the first time was in 96, and this is the second time around. And me and Eric didn't play in 96. It was our first Olympics as well, but... It was put in right away as a gold medal sport in 1996.
And so it was a trial sport? You're saying it went in immediately. It wasn't a trial sport. And how do they figure out what's going to be a trial sport? I thought all of them had to be a trial sport for one Olympic season. They just decided to muster this one right in?
Yeah, the guy that runs the FIVB is pretty powerful, and... He pushed hard and got it in. I think he's pretty tight with the IOC, so we were real fortunate in that aspect to get in right away and not have a trial period. We were right in there.
And you guys were, kind of the dark horses of this Olympic volleyball season, right? I mean, you guys weren't supposed to even medal, were you?
Well, I think Dan and I believe we can medal, but
you guys, of course, always think that, or you might make the trip, but I mean, no one else, not even your immediate family, right?
No, I think we had an opportunity, and we made the best of it, and, just believed in ourselves, and I think that's probably the most important thing.
Oh, I'll tell you, there's, you know, the worst part I could imagine would be going in as a heavy favorite and not coming home with anything. I mean, you're the dream team basketball team. You beat a country by 8 points and people are pissed off. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
but this got to be the sweetest.
Yeah, it was sweet. Like you said, we went in and we didn't have a lot of media pressure. People weren't putting a lot of pressure on us to do well. Like you're talking about the dream team, if they do anything other than first, they failed their task, and a lot of people are disappointed.
Even first isn't good enough if it's not by big enough margin.
Right. And the Brazilians had that type of pressure. Everybody had favored them to win, so they had a lot of pressure on them. So we didn't, other than the pressure that we put on ourselves, which was pretty big. But
You guys have a lot of endorsement deals and that kind of stuff? I mean, you're both good-looking guys, and you're young, and I imagine there's Madison Avenue has come calling. Am I right?
Yeah, things are happening, and hopefully bigger things will happen. But I'm in between sponsorship deals. We're both sponsored by Oakley.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, things definitely change when you win a gold medal.
Have you had any bizarre... You know what I like? I like when companies that have nothing to do with beach volleyball or whatever the sport is try to get the endorsement of the guy. You know, it's like, and they make that awkward transition where they go, after years on the PGA circuit, I can appreciate a good wood-burning log, a good man-made. And that's why I choose Duraflame logs. So Duraflame, hole-in-one with me. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
You got anything weird? Any products?
Not as of yet. I mean, we'd hope to do something like Duraflame.
They're wanting something weird. You see?
Yeah, why not?
Well, you guys, you must have immediately got, did you have managers and agents and people approaching you?
Like we both have managers and agents right now, so now we're going after companies, and companies, instead of closing their door, they're actually opening them and opening them wide.
Is there a sort of thing where you have to sort of strike while the iron is hot?
I think so. I think you have to capitalize on it.
Take away 15 years, Adam. It's all right.
Oh, shut up. Shut Drew's mic. I'm trying to conduct an interview here, Drew.
But yeah, I think it's hot, and you need to ride the wave, but... The unique thing about the Olympics is it comes only every 4 years, so for the next 4 years, we're sure to be the top team on the last Olympics. Right.
And do you want to do the,
2004.
2004 Olympics? Well, they could do the winter. Who knows? Do you want to do it, or is it too early to think about it?
It's never, like, too early to get into 2004, but, you know, we're going to... You know, enjoy our 2000 win, and in 4 years, I'm sure we'll be better veterans than we are now, and better at the game of volleyball, and probably a lot smarter. So, sure, we'd love to go for it again.
Did you guys have girlfriends before you went to Sydney? Because I know you don't now. I mean, this has to be one of the biggest trim sports there is, this beach volleyball
sport.
If you think about it. Do you know what I mean? As far as this is the physique that women are looking for. We always yell this.
Tennis was in the 70s.
We yell this at guys all the time who say, I'm 5'9 and I'm lifting a lot of weights and I'm 235 and I want to get up to 250. And I always tell them that chicks don't want that. They want the long and lean. But you guys play in your underpants. So it's like, I mean, imagine this sport in terms of, it's like an advertisement for single men. There you are, you're wearing a pair of trunks, you're all greased up, you got some cool sunglasses on, and you're diving into sand. I mean, women are winning. Women are going through panties watching this. I mean, what other sport you're playing out in the sun, you're all greased up and your shirt's off. You know what I'm saying, Drew?
It's definitely a sex appeal sport, but I have a fiance, and we're getting married soon.
Oh,
so,
okay.
All right. Yeah, that's a good thing.
All right. She's listening. I see. And Dain, what about you? Dain? you're playing the field, right? You're not stupid.
I am single right now.
Okay.
But
it's good.
No fiance, and I'm not ready to get married yet. Eric's got a few years on me.
Now,
and
right,
I figure I'll be there when I'm his age.
Now, when you go out clubbing, do you bring the gold medal? I mean, I know you bring it with you, but do you wear it outside of the jacket, or do you tuck it in the shirt and let it sort of fall out halfway into the tape?
The shirt button down here with the middle.
I think I should let you borrow it for a night.
Oh, my God. Drop it right down my pants. Listen, I got a surprise for you. Just look down there. Come on. All right. Eric had brought the gold medals. Is that true?
Yeah, I did. You want to check
it
out?
Yeah, this I wanted. This is the closest I'm ever going to get to this.
Dain brought his, but...
Dain, I saw Dain out in the parking lot getting it off the hood of his car, so he was able to bring it in. Wow.
Man.
Wow. You know how many fillings this is, Drew? This is amazing.
40,000.
My gosh. Is this gold? I mean, I know it sounds stupid. Is this...
Yeah, I don't know what the content is. I know it's not pure gold.
Well, let's find out. Drew, you got a ballpoint pen? Let's see if we can get into this thing.
It's probably gold-plated is what it is.
Oh, my God.
Maybe like 10%, I want to say.
See, I didn't know they put the sport on it. I never even thought about that.
Or the name.
Did you know that?
No,
I didn't know that either.
I've never seen one of these
before. when do you get this? How long... The one they present to you up on the medal stand.
Yeah, that's it.
Same one.
That's it.
Got your name on already?
Yeah. I took it right after and got it engraved. They do engraving right after for your name, but everything else is all finished.
So they have the beach volleyball men thing. And what about the I'm gonna keep this. What about the gold medal itself? Does this look the same as every other gold
medal?
They're
all the same. They just have the different event on the back, and if you want to put your name on the back, also you can engrave it as you were there. Though
every Olympics, the front of the gold has that goddess on the front. I'm not sure what her name is, but that's how the front of all the gold medals are. They definitely change them up every four years.
Oh, so this is the front?
Yeah,
here, and then the back is the
the torch is on the side.
That is beautiful. Those Aussies have gotten so much mileage out of that opera house. Yeah. Is there any other structure, freestanding structure, in Sydney or in all of Australia? Because there's nothing that exists without that in the background. You know what I mean? Every picture, every logo, every insignia, every brochure, everything, there is that goddamn opera house back there. Did you guys get over there? Did you have... Now, you guys won. How much time after you guys won, did you hang out for a few days before you came back?
We were there for a couple days. We had some family and friends there to celebrate with us, but we didn't media as soon as we were done. We went to a place, AT&T had this unbelievable place that took care of our family and friends. They fed them. They had the internet so you can communicate back at home.
Right.
But, you know, we got to see Darling Harbor. We got to see the Opera House. We went to the zoo. We saw a little bit, but, you know, we were really focusing on the event.
Right. Oh, my God.
Yeah, one of the biggest things, I think, or the funnest things after was Sports Illustrated threw a real big party, and that was a blast, right across from the Opera House. So we never actually, or I never did, I don't know if Eric did, got to the Opera House, but I did a ton of stuff right around it, everything. Yeah.
And you know, I imagine in your sport, unlike maybe track and field or boxing or something, you didn't grow up dreaming of the Olympics.
No, well, I mean, it wasn't available, exactly. But, I mean, you always dreamed about being in the Olympics and being an Olympian and then eventually, hopefully, become a medalist. But, no, it wasn't available and kind of just hoped for it.
And what about indoor volleyball? Do you think about that? Do you play that? I mean, could you go out for that Olympic team? Not that you'd want to, but...
You know, when I grew up, I started playing volleyball at about 12, and I was playing on the beach, down on Laguna Beach, and as you grow up, you start playing club volleyball and high school volleyball and college volleyball, and that was all the traditional six-person indoor volleyball. But
right.
As soon as I graduated in 94, I knew I wanted to play on the beach. I didn't want to play indoor anymore, and I think that was the same with Eric.
Yeah, the indoor guys are big. They're like 6'8", and it's not a whole lot of fun, I don't think, because you specialize in what you do indoors. You're either a big middle blocker, or you're an outside hitter who passes. And beach volleyball, you're well-rounded. You got to be a good passer, you got to be a good hitter, and you got to be a good setter. If you're not, then you're picked on whatever your weakness is, and they exploit it. And then pretty much, if you have any weakness, you're out of the game.
And the thing about playing on the sand, though, is it's like a bad dream. You know when you have a bad dream and some giant's chasing you, and you're running and something, but you're not getting anywhere? I mean, trying to jump up when you're in sand and get over that net, it seems almost impossible. Drew, I know you've played a fair amount of beach volleyball,
I did,
right?
Yeah. In Laguna.
Oh, really?
I don't think.
Did you guys meet over at the Rusty Pelican for a smart cocktail after a good day of spiking or anything? You guys don't know each other from the circuit?
Were you at Main Beach that we played?
Yeah. Exactly.
Wow. Wow. All right. We will take ourselves some phone calls and talk more about volleyball. Dave?
Yeah, what's up?
You're 22. What's going on?
Not much. Well, I started out most of my life as a right-handed masturbator, and after I started taking antidepressants, it's been about 6 months, I've only been able to masturbate with my left hand.
Oh, it must be the antidepressants.
Now, here's something I wish they'd make a trial sport, because I could really go represent.
Yes, oh man, you'd medal.
I'd bring home a lot more than the gold. I'd bring home some crabs and a hamper. Yeah, and you switched. Thank you. And now what?
Well, my question is, well, I mean, obviously it's pretty clear that there are some weird sexual side effects from antidepressants, but, you know, I've definitely experienced those, but it's just like, it seems coincidental, I guess, but it was just a bizarre thing. It's like I'm trying to, like, hit lefty when I was a right-handed, you know, batter or something, you know, it's like or throw a ball at my...
You smoke a bunch of pot, too?
What?
You smoke a lot of pot, too?
Me? No, actually, I'm the recovering alcoholic.
Okay.
All right. I've been sober for about a year and a half.
All right, but listen, if it's uncomfortable, why don't you just get back to the hand God intended you to whack off with, which is your right hand.
My point is I can't masturbate with my right hand anymore now that I've taken the antidepressants. It's just a very bizarre thing, and I wanted to... I was curious if Drew had any explanation for what causes, like, the lack of sexual... you know, lack of inability to have an orgasm.
Oh, that's the serotonin.
On your right side?
Just in general. It just doesn't feel right with my right hand.
The whole change in your libido, change in your arousal cycles, change in the orgasmic function.
How do you account for the fact that it works with his left hand?
These are what are called levoisomers. They're left-handed isomers. Are you a chemist, Dave?
Am I a chemist? No.
Yeah, okay.
Shocking.
But the fact is that's just some sort of weird coincidence. All right. It's all a result of the alteration of serotonin simultaneously.
Yeah, I tried both hands once, and my nuts looked up to me and went, who are you kidding? Penis is laughing its ass off. You barely need one hand. You could use a back scratcher. Come on. Hey, all right, good times. Is your right hand jealous?
My right hand is
it's not talking to you? Pretty much just spends most of the time in the pocket now?
That's right.
All right.
Thanks a lot, guys.
Fantastic. I'm a left-handed guy, but I'm going to start working out with my right hand. As athletes, you guys know the importance of being able to use both hands, be ambidextrous. As I'm getting older, and if I have a stroke and my left side becomes paralyzed, I'll use my right hand to kill myself. You understand? I'm going to have to get good with that thing. All right. Jennifer.
Yeah.
You're 26.
Mm-hmm.
What's up?
My question is, I've been with my fiancé for about 5.5 years. We have two kids together. They're 4 and 3. And him and my sister betrayed me in July. They had sex together. And it was supposedly one of those things where, you know, when you do something and you're like, oh, what are we doing? We're not supposed to be doing this. One of those things. And now my mother thinks that...
Wait a minute. They realized they weren't supposed to be doing it?
Yes.
I see.
At what point, actually, I realized that... When did they sort of see through the subtleties of the situation and realize that perhaps this was not an appropriate behavior?
I'll do a little audio recreation. Yeah. Hey, this is wrong. That's how it works. It's not halfway into it. It's not when he's saying, hey, liquor store's still open. I can get you more wine coolers. Okay, just hang tight. I'll be back in 20. No, it's not that part. It's just seconds after the orgasm.
I understand it's such a subtle issue. I mean,
right.
Sister.
Right. And yes, it could go either way. Yeah. It's really a judgment call. Flip a coin whether you should bang your fiance's sister or not. In many cultures, it's accepted and embraced. Where's this guy from?
My fiance?
Yeah.
From Texas.
Well, Texas is one of the states where they encourage that. So it could be a cultural thing.
But now my question is, he is the one that came forward first.
Now, first off, I believe it's come forward first.
No, he told me that didn't happen.
Oh, I see. Ooh, who picked up?
No, I was changing phones.
Oh, I see.
My phone was going dead.
I see. No, okay, so he
was the one that came to me and told me
he came to her.
He's doing a lot of coming, this guy.
Okay.
And so why do you think, see, I would assert that the only reason he cummed to you is because
the sister was going to come anyway.
Yeah, the sister said she was on her.
My sister she doesn't deny it anymore, but she just recently, probably about a week ago, 2 weeks ago, apologized to me and admitted to it.
Okay, but why do you think he brought it up?
Because that night I was there. We were at my mother's, and she has a bunch of land, and I just had this funny feeling, and I fronted him with it. He denied it.
You found him?
No, I did not find them together, but afterwards they decided, oh, we're still going to talk outside, and then, you know, I woke up and seen them talking, and I just thought, this is kind of strange. And then basically, I knew something had happened. My mom knew something had happened. And then...
Right. You see, you can tell by the way the outhouse was shaking that something was going on in there, right?
Why would you tolerate... Well, why is this guy even your fiancé anymore?
We have two kids together.
I see.
Because of the kids, you're... Why didn't you get married before?
Because we both been married once before, and...
You're 26.
I got married in 93. We were only there... I was only with him for 3 months, and I left him.
What happened with him?
Well, I signed divorce papers and kind of found out we were never divorced.
Why did...
Oh, I see.
And so when I went to go marry my...
Hang on a second. Why did you divorce the first one?
Why? He was an alcoholic. He treated me bad.
Right. And I imagine this one's no Jewel himself.
Well, no.
Well, let's not rush to judgment. But first off, Drew, you have sex with one fiancé sister and a mate. Immediately you get labeled. Do you know what I'm saying?
So, Jennifer, your dad was an alcoholic?
Was my dad?
Mm-hmm.
I think he was when I was, you know, a child, but now I don't have a relationship with my father.
Oh, okay. Well, so no damage done. Okay, and listen, Jennifer, listen, screwball. They really got to start having IQ tests for kids, because you're going to screw those kids up faster than you got screwed up. Listen to me. This guy's in trouble. How? Please. You got another a-hole on your hands here. You got a guy who was having sex with your sister. Now you got two kids... with the guy who has sex with your sister as their dad, and a completely oblivious mom, which is you, as the mother. You got to take care of these kids. The first thing you got to do is not expose them to guys like this.
Go to Al-Anon. Go.
Okay. Jennifer?
But Michael's... Okay. I'm listening to y'all.
All right.
Okay, my question is, just because he did that does not make him a bad father.
Oh, yes, it does.
How? Because he mistreated me?
Because that is a direct... If I did that to my wife, it would be an attack on my children.
That's right. And then his wife would attack your scrotum with her boot.
She would be welcome.
Oh, you know she's listening, too.
No, I really feel strongly about that.
I know. Drew has told me. I've said to Drew quite a few times in the back of limousines and parts unknown, how about we get some hookers, you know, and Drew, or at least some college-age girls, and Drew, or, you know, Drew said high school, but I said, no, we go college, and we compromised on junior college, which I thought was younger, I didn't know, but Drew said, absolutely not, I look at that as a personal attack on my family, and then he checked me for a wire. No, he said he looks at that as a personal attack on his family.
As a direct attack.
Right, and then I laughed like a madman, but I did soak it in. All right, real quick.
No.
Jennifer?
Yeah.
Okay, listen. You know on some level that this guy's a bad guy, and that even though what your dad did to you makes you sort of very accepting
of
abuse.
Bad guys, yeah.
Wait, what did my dad do to me? What do you mean by that?
He abandoned you?
Well, no, actually I was 16 and I moved out.
He was an alcoholic?
He was when I was little.
That's when it really counts.
Right, but I don't remember those things.
Oh, you don't remember, but it's
indelible mark.
Right.
It's telltale mark.
Obviously. I mean, you know, any woman that does not have a relationship with her dad is going to have problems.
Okay.
Well, there you go.
You're one of them. Now, listen, here's the point. You can live your life in denial and go from crappy guy to crappy guy to abusive guy back to a crappy guy. Or you can start going to Al-Anon, get a little therapy, read a book, and start trying to clear your mind up a little bit on behalf of your two children who are going to magically grow up in the same kind of crappy environment you grew up in.
Unless you change. Unless you break that cycle.
Okay.
All right.
What if he's willing to change, too?
He needs to.
That's fine.
I'm not necessarily saying, by the way, break up myself.
Oh,
I'm saying you got some work to do, and he needs to do some, too. But you can only work on yourself. And if you get better, you're going to want to leave him. And if he has any desire to stay in this marriage, he'll get better, too.
All right.
Okay.
All right, Jennifer.
Thank you all.
All right. Bye. All right. It's nice to hear from white trash every once on this show. You know, we make much fun of the ethnic groups, but it's good to know that there's some white people that are really screwed up, too. All right. Dane and Eric are both here. They've taken home the gold, and they actually brought it into the studio. God bless them. We will take ourselves
it's
a little
so
break.
He's casual with that gold, too. He's lying around here. Oh, he put his Coke on top of it like a coaster.
I know. Yeah. And they handed it right over to us. I was about ready to make a break for the door.
I noticed that. It scared me.
All right. We'll take a little break. We'll be back. It's Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew, Dain Blanton, and Eric Fonoimoana.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Getting good at it.
They're our guests tonight. They are, of course, the American beach volleyball team who brought home the gold from Sydney and are just basking in it. And why not? I would, too. Oh, my God. Gold medal. Okay. You ready to get back on the phones here, Drew?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go.
Kelly?
Yes.
You're 25. What's up?
Well, last week I was at a club with some friends, and we took some ecstasy, and I don't normally do that. And this guy that I've liked for a little while was in there, and I ended up going home with him, and we were safe. We used protection and everything, but right before he finished, he went to pull out, and the condom didn't, and I was curious if, even though I didn't really come in contact with it, if I should still be concerned.
You mean the condom had to be fished out?
It didn't have to be fished out, but it didn't come out with him. I mean, it was hanging there.
Hanging. Like an elephant trunk kind of thing.
Sort of, yeah. It was pretty gruesome.
Yeah. But it wasn't a guy with a big gray beard and waiters didn't come on smoking a pipe and have to get it out. I mean, Gordon's
no,
fisherman.
There were no Gordon scenes.
I see. All right. And talking like the Pepperidge Farm guy.
Yeah.
So you got it out. So the end was outside of you.
So whatever spilled out stayed outside.
Yeah.
So
as
that's
far
fine.
As I know, I mean, but...
You should be fine.
Okay.
Should be.
I wasn't sure.
Because usually when that happens, though, it gets crammed back in, and you have to go to the doctor to get it pulled out, and it's a big
deal. No. I mean, it was just...
Let's clarify. For anybody whom that does happen to, it does put you at risk for toxic shock. It does need to be fished out quickly.
Oh, no. It was out, like, within a
second. I understand. But I'm just, for anyone else listening, this is a common problem.
Yeah.
It's okay. Part of the ways condom fails.
Why, what about a biodegradable condom, one you can keep in there?
Like cat gut condom that just dissolves?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sure. Why not? You know what I mean?
How about just all season, all year? You know, wear it all the time.
Oh, you just keep it
some
in there.
Some sort of liner, yeah.
Nice. Mm. Yeah, that's called taking a good idea and making it better. It's fine.
So,
yeah,
so
one made out of marzipan or something that would dissolve after just a couple hours.
Tastes good, too.
leave a sweet residue on the man's penis. All right, Kelly?
Yeah.
Yeah, all right, that's good. Yeah,
so
you're fine. What happened? He tried to pull out and you clamped down on him, or?
No. God, no. I was pleased that he did that, but
yeah.
I've never encountered that sort of problem.
You're supposed
before,
to, you so. Guys are supposed to grab the base of the condom when they pull out, because
yeah.
They do fall off pretty easily.
Obviously, he's not real quick.
Yeah.
All right. Well, was he drunk or high or something?
Yeah, we were on ecstasy.
Okay, well, that'll do it. It happened to me once. My both hands, I was calling some of my friends, telling them I got laid. I didn't have a hand free. Yeah. Yeah, I should have waited until I got out of the room or something. I just can't, you know, it's like you got some good news you want to share. All right, Kelly, you're fine there.
All right, thank you.
Good time, so.
Bye.
All right. Emily.
Hello?
You're 21.
Yeah. My question is, about a month ago, I performed oral sex on someone, later to find out he has herpes, and I didn't know, like, how at risk I was.
Did you get an outbreak?
Well, I don't know really anything about it. Recently,
you would know it. Listen, there would be no mistaking. You get a painful ulcerations in your mouth.
He had genital herpes?
Okay, he didn't penetrate me or anything. It was just all oral sex.
I understand. You can get the herpes there, in your mouth.
Okay, in your mouth, but can I get it, like, down there, too?
Because not unless there was contact.
Okay, because, I don't know, recently there have been, like, blister-like looking things down there.
Did you have genital contact with him?
No, that's what I was confused about.
I don't see how that could happen.
Okay, then, I don't know. Great, then it's something else.
Yeah, it's probably cancer.
Okay.
Yeah, don't worry.
Oh, phew.
You can rest easy tonight.
So
your vagina's falling off.
So by doing oral sex with someone who might have herpes, it would only show up in the mouth then?
Only shows the outbreak. It's at the point of contact.
All right, okay. So Drew, let me get this straight. You can go from the genitalia to the mouth.
And the mouth to the genitalia.
Right. What about if you got it in your mouth and you're sucking some boob?
You can do that. It's
really?
Harder. I'd like
to try that one.
That skin's not easy to penetrate with virus.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah, but if one was really tenacious?
Yeah, or if you bit down or got some... Calm down.
You know what always grosses Drew out? I tell him as a man I like a little nipple play. You know, it's something I enjoy. Drew always gets repulsed. And I mean, come on, you guys, be honest. It's nothing. That's erogenous zone on a man too, right?
It's not for kids only.
Yeah, I mean, what's wrong with that? Drew, why does that repulse you so much?
More than I can bear.
Yeah, sometimes when I'm having it myself, I like to, you know, work my own nipples a little bit.
Somehow,
right?
Yeah, somehow the image of you masturbating is not nearly as offensive to me.
Is me getting a little nipple action?
It's impossible.
Yeah.
You know, I have very sensitive nipples.
It's true. Tom?
Yes.
You're 30.
Yes.
What is up?
My question basically is, how many times do you allow, like, a girlfriend to lie to you before you kind of lose trust?
2.7.
Yeah. That's within a one-year period.
Exactly.
Now,
we've been together for, like, a year.
Well, 2 years, obviously, it's 3.4, and it just keeps going up. You do the math.
What's the situation?
5.4.
What is the deal?
I need a calculator.
What is the situation?
Well, just like about 2 months ago, she said that she was driving home after an event. She said she drove home.
After what?
After a family event.
I see.
She said she drove. Her car was parked at a friend's, and she said she drove home, which I checked the next morning, which she did not, and I confronted it to her a week later, and still denied. So you know, I believe that she lied about it. And
so one time,
says, you know, once he found out that a girl ever lies, he just cuts them off completely.
Your friend said that.
Yes, with his girlfriend. No, I'm not saying that that's the right thing to do, but I'm just wondering.
But these are your friends. So how much can you trust them?
I'm sorry?
Yeah, Tom's Mr. Excitement over here.
Yeah.
Tom, let me guess. I'm going to guess what you do for a living.
Okay.
I believe you're one of those guys who call square dances. You know what I mean? Element left, do-si-do, right-hand swing, that kind of thing?
I'm not that quick.
That's not you?
No.
Auctioneer?
No, it has to be an auctioneer.
Auctioneer. Right?
Rap artist.
No. All right. Tom, if she's consistently lying about that kind of stuff, then I think you should break up with her.
Yeah, I'm not sure what the consistency is. I don't...
Look, is this relationship working?
To that point.
Is the relationship working or not? Is she into it or not?
Yeah, she's into it, but then we're kind of on hold right now.
Why are you on hold?
Well, because she's going through some family court stuff, and it's just kind of easier.
Okay. That is not her being into it.
She ain't into it.
That's her being done with the relationship.
Okay. Tom.
Okay, now,
Tom, let me ask you a question. Forget about how many times they can lie to you. How many times can you lie to yourself?
Good question.
You guys.
What show is this?
I'd bring home the gold for that. Yeah, that is true. Listen, how many times have we talked about this?
Yeah, men particularly.
Yeah, men do this. You guys have done this, I'm sure. All guys do it, especially when you're younger. You talk yourself into stuff that is just not the truth. I mean, the bottom line is if a woman wants to be with you, she will be with you.
That's
just
it.
Like you will be with her if you want to be with her. And everything else can be damned. All this family, whatever, job, whatever, travel, whatever. You'll work it out, right? I mean, you'll make it happen. And if it ain't happening, it ain't happening, no matter what they say. She doesn't sound like she's into this one. All right. Tom doesn't sound like he's got a good ear for that. Jeremy?
Yeah?
You're 14?
Yeah. My uncle molested me.
Yeah. Don't believe it.
No, sorry.
All right, see ya.
All right, bye-bye.
Yeah. You could tell it's not, the affect wasn't there.
Yeah.
That wasn't real.
It was funny. It's like his buddy was going like, dude, no, hold on. So he was practicing.
Yeah, tell me. Say,
hey, my uncle molested. No, man. You're upset. Your uncle molested
no,
you.
No, it's, my uncle molested me.
You guys, these guys got sand in their ears. They knew that was a lie, right? You didn't believe that, right?
Nah, that was pretty shady.
Don't take any offenses, but how long does it take to get the sand out of you, if you know what I'm saying, after one of those things where you're diving? I mean, you must take home half that beach in your shorts.
That's not as bad as you think.
Really?
You do find sand later, some, you know, in the ears.
Yeah, in places. Yeah, yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Crevices.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Let's take a break.
You want to do that?
Yeah.
All right. All righty. Dain and Eric are both here. They both have themselves a big, fat gold medal, which they've brought into the studio, obviously, from the Sydney Olympics. We'll come back and we'll talk to Jason, who's going to congratulate the boys after this. Yeah. It is Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. John Cryer will be in here tomorrow night. My neighbor, by the way, he lives right across the street from me. So I called him tonight and told him I was going to pick him up. He's got that new, what is it, The Trouble with Normal? Is that the new ABC sitcom? Replace
yeah,
my
sure.
my beloved Sabrina the Teenage Witch or whatever on TGI Friday, but he'll be in there tomorrow night. Dain Blanton and Eric Fonoimoana. Fonoimoana.
Keep going.
Yeah. They're both here tonight. If you watched the Olympics, or even if you didn't watch the Olympics, you still probably knew that these guys took home the gold in the beach volleyball. The most glamorous of all the Olympic sports, I would say. Certainly the best for the chicks. And when'd you guys see the Olympics wrapped up a couple of weeks ago? And you guys, I guess I saw the news where you guys, they always do that thing where they send the camera down to the airport and then they have the guys coming off the plane. It's a weird kind of thing. And then they come off the plane and their family's there. And they go, here they are. They're coming off the plane. And there they go. Well, they're back. And I was glad to see that you guys got back. You had the gold medals. And, you know, it'd be funny if you just give them your gold medal a couple of fat tourists who are sitting behind you and let them walk off in front of you. Screw with Fred Rogan a little. All right, so the guys are here. Oh, and I want to talk about these guys both have sort of foundations, I guess you would call them, or programs. Let's talk about that. I guess we'll start with Dain. What is, talk about your program.
Well, my program is, it's called Dain's Day at the Beach, and I created it back in 1997 after I'd won my first event. And what it is, it's a program that goes all throughout the United States, and it introduces volleyball to kids, usually at a boys and girls club or a YMCA, that haven't been introduced to the sport of beach volleyball. And I usually do it at stops that the tour goes to, the United States AVP tour. I get the kids out there. We go over the skills of volleyball. I speak to them about goal setting, and a little bit about my background and how I've gotten to where I am today. And I also invite them out to the event, try to get them tickets, because there's really, you can talk about beach volleyball, you can watch it on TV all you want, but once you're at the event, it's a lot different. It makes a lot more of an impact on kids when they're right there.
And what about, do most of these facilities now have a little beach set up in them, some sand where you can play beach volleyball?
Well, when I run the program, our tour is there usually on that weekend. Other than that, if you're in a city that doesn't have a beach, it's definitely more difficult. But if there is no beach, you know, you teach them indoor stuff.
But like, for instance, a lot of fraternity houses will have, like, some sand set up in front. Or there'll be, like, at colleges, they have sand set up where you can play beach volleyball. Does some of these YMCAs and places like that have that now?
You know what? I haven't come across that. That would be nice if it was, but those are usually pretty expensive to build and even more expensive to just maintain.
Well, you know why? Because cats crap in them. You ever step in a cat crap? Cats see that, they go nuts, especially inner city cat. Can't walk around but cramping on cement and, you know, trash can lids and stuff.
You and
it,
your friends.
My drunken friends may look at that. Well, certainly, yes. Thank you, Drew. I see a big ashtray. Look at that. Good for everything. Cigarettes, throw up, urine. Perfect. Perfect. All right, and Eric, what about, and by the way, you can do DainBlanton.com, which is one big long word, right?
One big long word, no spaces.
D-A-I-N, and Blanton is pretty much how it's spelled, right? B-L-A-N-T-O-N.com, if you want some more information about that. And Eric, let's talk about your foundation.
It's called Dig for Kids. It's D-I-G for kids. And what it is...
Well, these are kids who are hit by avalanches?
No, it's actually a term in volleyball that when you do a defensive play, it's called a dig.
Mm, write that down, Drew.
Yeah, yes. Just in case you go down
dig for
start
kids.
Digging down at the beach.
Right.
Different terminology. But we start in City of Carson, and what we do is an hour and a half of academics and an hour and a half of volleyball. And in the classroom goes first. We stress academics, making sure that people get an education and learn how to study. We tutor to them at that time. It started September 20th, and it goes on for 12 weeks every Wednesday from 3 to 6. So it's kind of like an after-school program.
And I'm guessing the volleyball's after the academics.
Exactly. So. Volleyball's secondary, because if you don't study, you don't get to play volleyball.
Right. We got to hang that carrot out there, because no way those kids hanging.
If we did the opposite, I think they'd be all sweaty and then running around.
Yeah,
so.
It's like that's why you don't get paid on Monday morning. You don't show up Tuesday. All right, and how do they get hold of you? Digforkids.com?
Yeah, it's a website that has more information and more in detail what we do. We also do clinics, but we're definitely looking for donations.
Hey, in Samoan, does Moana mean something? Everybody's Ala Moana, Fauna Moana.
Yeah, Fonoimoana actually means meeting by the sea.
So Samoana is by the sea?
Yeah, so it's like kind of ironic that I play beach volleyball.
Nice. All right. You ready to go here, guys?
Mm.
Let's talk to Jason, who's 14. Jason?
Yo.
Yo.
Hey, I just want to congratulate Eric and Dain, because that's really good how you guys won.
Did you watch them?
No.
You couldn't just go, yeah?
I should have lied to us.
Like they're going to test you?
I'm not going to lie to you guys.
All right, well, you didn't watch any of the Olympics?
I watched a few things.
But you missed the guys who won the gold. Who you're congratulating?
Are you a volleyball fan?
What?
Are you a volleyball fan?
Oh, the biggest.
Yeah, it's good band.
Good band. where are you from, Jason? Band.
San Francisco.
Okay. So why do you want to congratulate them?
Hey, by the way, how's the weather up there? I'm going up there tomorrow.
Kind of rainy.
That's what I thought.
Good. All right, you want to... How do you know they won the gold?
We've been talking about it.
I guess so. All right, what... Are you interested in volleyball?
Kind of.
Honestly. You're going to be honest with us.
Yes.
Do you know what volleyball is?
Yes.
You understand the ball does not have a rope on it and go around a pole.
Yes.
It's tetherball. It's totally different, which I believe should be an Olympic sport, of course, with no ropeies. You know, we grab the rope. Always a source of controversy at Colfax Elementary when someone dibs the no ropeies, but it was not declared loud enough so that the opponent could hear it. Always some trouble. No ropeies. All right, Eric, the guys appreciate you, and it's dedicated fans like yourself that make this sport possible. And as a matter of fact, the guys are telling me off the air they won the gold for you.
Thanks for meeting with the airport, too.
Okay, and what happened to your lava lamps?
That's a good good question.
Anderson sort of nixed that.
Yeah, I was not allowed to bring the C word up. And I didn't realize that.
Didn't have the same poetic alliteration without...
Yeah.
Try it now without saying it.
C-rings, just C-rings and lava lamps. It was a store that I was looking to franchise in the malls. Just C-rings and lava lamps. And as it turned out, we couldn't say the entire word. After we'd mentioned 157 times, by the way. It's not a science, this radio, apparently. All right, let's just say real high. Let's talk to Mike real quick. Mike?
Real high,
yes. Mike, you're 19.
Yeah, I am.
Yeah, you met a girl, and she's already talking about marriage.
Yeah,
and
well, check this out.
You've only been together for 8 years?
Nah, man. I've never even, been with her.
I see.
They share the love of pot, though.
What?
You guys both love pot?
Nah. Well, this is what happened, right?
Only you love pot?
Yeah.
That's right.
All right.
Okay, hold on a second, Mike. Mike?
Yeah?
I want you to, you make love your bong during the break, all right?
Oh, okay.
All right. Didn't take much encouragement. We'll take a little break, and then we'll get back and get to the bottom of your problem, okay? All right. Dain and Eric are both here, gold medal winners from Sydney in beach volleyball. We'll take a little break. We'll be right back. Yep, it is Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Tomorrow night, John Cryer will be in here. He's going to kick me in the nuts if he hears me say this, but you probably still remember him as Ducky Boy in Pretty in Pink, although that was 33 years ago. But he's my neighbor, so I told him I'm going to pick him up, and he's going to come in here and talk about the trouble with Normal. It's a new ABC show tomorrow night. Dain Blanton is here tonight, and so is Eric Fonoimoana. Fonoimoana.
Moana.
Moana. Moana. Fonoimoana, which means more poi in... Oh, Jesus, those names. Those Samoan names. Is that a Samoan name?
Yeah.
What is it? Are they just screwing with us over there?
It's just a lot of vowels makes you pronounce words.
Oh, I know, but why can't they be shorter? You know, like the Chinese, you know, a guy's name, last name like Chin or Hoi or something. It's great, you know?
Lee.
How can you screw up Lee? You put another E on it, you're still good. You can't misspell it. You can't screw it up. Lee. Yeah. There's so many of them, too. I'm going to go over there. Start pronouncing some names. You could pronounce, you know, millions and millions of names over there, right? There's no tough Chinese names, is there?
I'm sure there are.
Really? Yeah. You think so?
I think so.
I don't know. I think it works. Plus, now, I feel sorry for all these guys, these Samoan guys starting to make it into the NFL now. And it's, oh, boy, it's John Saliamuala Mahana Mahana. That's on a tackle.
I think
on a tackle.
Make you say it correctly.
Yeah, what is, there's a guy, oh, man, there's, I think.
It's always when there's two U's that they get all screwed up. Two U's and two A's in the same name, side by side.
There's a, yeah, there's a, there's a running back for, Steelers, yeah.
Arizona always had, University of Arizona always had a bunch of.
Oh, they
Lions.
Did?
Yeah.
Really?
Right, yeah.
Why? What's up with
they
that?
They recruited from there.
All right, the Steelers. Yeah, they got number 45 as like a fullback or something on that team. He's got a hell of a boy. He's got a mouthful. And a lot of those announcers are drunk by the third quarter, so it's a forget it. They just, I think they just start calling him down home at a certain point.
Oh, my God.
They just lost. They couldn't do it anymore. Don Ho came in here, by the way, was stoned, wasn't he?
Yeah.
They think Don Ho was stoned?
If he wasn't, he...
He should have been.
Yeah.
I said to Don, hey, Don, you own half that island, right? I said, yeah. And no, he went, yeah. I said, you grow any pot on that land? He was like, oh. Just started laughing.
And here he comes now.
Is he here? Let's hear him. That's good.
Mahalo.
That's He sounds like a wind instrument, that guy, without a reed, you know?
More like the big jug that somebody would be blowing into.
Yeah, you know when you try to blow into a cider jug, but you don't get anything out of it? Everything is... All right, well...
Aloha. This is Don Ho, and you're listening to Loveline with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
Why not? Mike?
Yeah, what's going on, man?
All right, so you're 19.
Yeah. All right.
You met a girl. She's already talking about marriage.
Yeah. It's tripping me out, because check this out. I met her last week, right? On Monday, I met her over the phone.
How'd you meet her?
Through a friend.
Hmm.
Yeah, she just referred me to her, and I was like, oh, okay.
Referred?
Yeah, you know, it's like a dentist or something.
Yeah. Yeah, and so we just started talking on the phone, right? And I set up to, like, meet her on Tuesday. And so I went and, like, I went to go meet her, right? And, like, she was, like, all over me, like, just, like filling me up and shit. Like,
Hey, Mike, you know my cursing policy. I may have to put you on hold. I think Anderson already did.
Yeah.
Anderson's enforcing my policy for me. All right, listen, if she's feeling you up on the first date and she seems a little crazy and you met her over the phone,
she is.
Maybe this isn't the one for you. And Mike, Mike, it sounds like he deserves royalty. He really does. He shouldn't settle for anything less than a princess. Hymen intact. He really sounds like one of the royal family. Alicia?
Yes.
It's Mike, yeah.
Hi.
Using his bong, it's a scepter, by the way. Mike, you're 23. What's up? I mean, sorry, Alicia, you're 23.
Yeah, hi. Thank you so much for taking my call.
Sure.
My boyfriend is an addict, and everyone is telling him that if he sticks with the NA program, then it will work for him, but he doesn't believe in God, and I don't think he ever could believe in the type of God that he would need to in order.
Now, from an intellectual standpoint, the purpose of the God concept is to get somebody comfortable with feeling powerless, and just having faith that in spite of feeling completely powerless over this very intense disease, things are going to turn out okay. Just have faith that things will be okay, that you don't have to be in control, and that to experience the powerlessness associated with this disease is to begin the process of dealing with the reality of the disease. And but unless you have some faith in something that things are going to be okay, it's too horrifying to experience that.
What about the atheists and the agnostics?
That's fine.
But how do they get a feeling of powerlessness?
They just have faith that there is some good in the universe, or that things are going to be okay for them. They have their own concept of what this is.
I heard a new program was sending them down to the Department of Building and Safety to try to pull a permit on a garage.
You need a lot of faith for that.
I heard that was a way to make a man feeling.
But Alicia, he just doesn't want to get well. Is the thing? Is he a heroin addict?
Well, sort of.
There's no sort of heroin addict.
Well, painkillers.
Yeah, he's an opiate addict. The opiate addiction needs to be treated in a hospital. I'm firmly of that belief.
Well, he's in a hospital, but, like, in terms of long-term, for the rest of his life.
He's got to go to NA every day. And aren't there
any other alternative 12-step
Not that
program?
Look, he has to be on his knees willing to do whatever he has to do. And obviously he's not ready right now. But he also should be in a sober living when he gets out of there for a while. Because, again, opiate addiction, extremely high recidivism.
Alicia, are you a religious person?
Well, sort of. I mean, I'm Jewish. I believe in God.
Your parents are pissed.
Why?
Oh, I went to junkie already.
No, they actually
are you kidding?
About him.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, most Jewish parents would be very upset you're dating a junkie.
And they're by the way, in order for him to actually get better, you have to change too. Or you subconsciously will keep him the same person that has been the drug addict. And he needs to make substantive emotional change. And you've got to go to Al-Anon. And you have to be working a program as diligently as he is. Or the relationship, I'm telling you, will not survive. Or he will die of his disease, one or the other.
Why are you kidding me? Your parents are all right with the junkie? I can't get over that. There's not a Jewish mother alive who'd go for that.
He's across the country right now living with his mother, so he's not here. But they actually let him stay with them when he tried to detox.
No. No way you can do it. You can't detox Matt as an outpatient.
Yeah.
No
right.
way.
Right. Well, he's in a hospital right now.
Good, but you got to start going Al-Anon immediately. He is not going to stay well unless you make some change, too.
What got you into this?
Well, we were together for like
no.
2.5 years.
He means.
What do you mean, into this?
Yeah, where's the attraction? Jewish parents. There's no
eating disorder.
No
intrusion.
Intrusion, eating disorder. What do you got going?
No, I don't have anything going on. I mean,
I knew it.
Knew what?
I knew you had nothing going on. I could feel it. What do you got going on?
Well, I mean, I've struggled with depression and stuff.
Yeah, that's it?
But, I mean, that's kind of what we initially bonded on because we both struggled with it. And
so, yeah, that's what codependents are. They see the pain that they experience in another person. They can't tolerate it. They have to expunge that pain, rescue them from that pain, lest they should have to experience it as well themselves.
Yeah, I have that, but just to a certain point. I see the pain that I have in other people and then decide to nap. Which is right up to the brink of wanting to expunge it from them, but then I get sleepy.
No, you don't nap.
I do.
You masturbate. Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry. You're right. I masturbate.
Then you nap.
On it. You know, some people...
Over it.
A lot of people like to, they say, let me sleep on it. Let me get a little time with it. I like to masturbate on it. A big business decision, a contract that needs to be... Someone puts a contract in front of me. I say, let me whack off on it.
For a few minutes.
Just give me a couple minutes. Let me whack off on it. And I'll get back to you on it. Okay. Is it laminated? And there's always some confusion when I use the word on it. I choose my words better now. Brian?
Hi, how are you doing, Adam?
Good, you're 24. What's up?
Well, lately, after having intercourse with my girlfriend, mm-hmm. after I orgasm, I've been getting these massive headaches.
Are you on any medication?
No, not at all.
Do you have any history of migraines?
No.
You need to have a doctor take a look at that.
Okay. I mean, it's just been, like, since Saturday.
Do you get any numbness, tingling, visual disturbances, anything else and with that?
Vision's been a little blurred during these headaches.
Yeah, you got, you...
I mean, they don't last. I mean, they last for maybe...
There are orgasmic-type migraines, but you need to have this looked at, seriously. You got before you do anything again, have a doctor examine you, okay?
I mean, what could it possibly
well,
be?
Well, it's probably just a migraine-type phenomenon, but there can be aneurysms and other things that can be presenting this way.
Yeah. All right.
The fact that you're having blurred vision and other neurologic symptoms is what really bothers me. So just get it checked out.
All right. Let me ask the guys some questions. Do you guys have to play with your shirts off?
No.
There's no rule.
There's no rule.
It's kind of the code of the beach, though.
It's the beach. It's hot. It's sunny. Sand. I mean, with the shirt wet. Right. I mean, sand everywhere.
It's their uniform.
A pair of trunks.
That's what they're used to playing. You know what I mean? It's like any of the sports. The uniform.
Yeah, I understand, but I just wonder if there's some sort of rule, because you never see... Well, once in a while I see a guy with a tank top or something like that.
Those one-piece things.
So is that big... A one-piece?
A unitard?
True. You don't see any guy in a unitard.
Yeah, I think I've seen
that. No.
That's the sprinter, the track sprinter.
Yeah. Yeah, true. You're making this up.
Actually, we do have rules on the international circuit. We do wear... tank tops.
Oh, really?
Yeah, in the United States, we don't.
All right. And what about, did some of these European guys, are they, these fruitcakes playing the Speedos? See any guys in Speedos
out there? I haven't seen that.
You haven't seen that?
Yeah.
Do you guys wear underpants?
No, I don't wear.
No, Speedos. Really?
No, not.
No, wait a minute. No, you anything under the shorts?
No, I wear board shorts, and that's the way it is.
Aren't you scared I'd be scared if one of my buddies from the audience would run out and drop my pants. You don't. You ever lose your pants?
No, not lately.
Really? Yeah. I'd wear suspenders or something. I'd put some duct tape around them or something, like a boxer's glove or something.
You carry a pistol, you can shoot your friends as they come at you.
Well, it'd be hard to play with the pistol down the trunks. Dain, you play, you wear underpants, jock strap, something like that?
Something like that. I wear just Speedos, you know. Just
underneath.
Yeah, underneath.
Beach.
Well, yeah, I'm trying to figure. It seems like there's a lot of people watching. You're doing a lot of diving. You know what I mean? Like half the time you go run and jump in the ocean, you come running out, your pants around your ankles, you don't even know it, right?
Yeah, the pants never fall down. You have the drawstring, and nowadays the shorts are so long.
Any guys wear shoes of any kind? I mean, not shoes, but some kind of, you know...
gear.
Some kind of something on the foot, one of those wet socks or something
only
like that.
Only when it gets real hot, sometimes people put on little sand socks, or if they're trying to tape up their ankle to protect the tape, but usually, well, you know, 9 out of 10 times, you don't see anything on the feet, anything on the, you know, no shirts. No, you know, the less, the better.
Yeah. Yeah, what happens if you get, like, a big zit on your back? You know?
It cooks off in a couple hours.
It does? Rub a little sand on it. Jesus, I tell you, you ever get that? You look at your back, you go, holy Christ, what happened? That happened to me tonight. I don't get zits on my back very much at all. I turn around, I was looking in the mirror today, there's something huge, like a cow's eye, was on my back. It was huge. I was like, oh my God, what happened here?
How's I?
Yeah, it was a huge zit. I don't get zits on my back very often at all.
It has to do with the fact that you haven't changed your clothing in 5 days.
Really?
You slept, worked, broadcast.
Oh, broadcast. Yeah, this is tough. Clothing. Yeah. I wear out a shirt or two every couple of weeks, sitting in this chair, yapping into this mic. How dare you, Drew? How dare you attack my hygiene? Please. Yeah, but I was thinking, with this zit on my back, no way. I'd withdraw from the tournament. I'd
wear
a
shirt.
Wear a shirt.
Yeah, and then people know. If you had an eye on your back, you'd be arrested for witchcraft or something.
Really, it was a cow's eye. It was a big zit. Dan?
Hey, yeah?
You're 15.
Yeah, what's up? I just want to say congratulations to Robin, to Eric and Dain.
Right, good.
Yeah. I was wondering if Dane's coming to San Francisco anytime soon.
I hope to. I have a lot of friends up there, but I don't have anything scheduled.
All right.
What's going on? What's going on in San Francisco?
Well, I play volleyball, and our team has been in like a slump. So, you know, I was wondering if you guys could come down.
Yeah. Hey, Hey, Dan?
Yeah?
You think this is an episode of Saved by the Bell?
No.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
See, this stuff only happens in sitcoms.
Mm-hmm.
It's like in the Brady Bunch, where Greg's trying out for the team, and then it's like, hey, it's Don Drysdale. Howdy, Greg. Listen, son, you got to stay in school. It was always freaked me out how Mr. Brady was friends with, like, Roman Gabriel and Don Drysdale and Davy Jones and stuff. He'd just bring them on in. Sure, and they'd always talk to him. Thanks, Mike. Listen, here's how you throw that. And it's like, I want to kick my dad in the nuts every time I saw one of those episodes. But you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, yeah.
You guys don't do this. This is a sitcom
Wasn't
scenario.
There a Joe Namath episode?
Yeah, Joe Namath shows up. It's always funny, too. It's like, this guy's a small-time architect in some town in California. Joe Namath flies out from New York. Hi, Mike. Anytime I can help the family, Mike. It's like, yeah, I guess he hangs with Joe, Broadway Joe. Sure, why not? I know my dad. I saw my dad chilling with Bart Starr last week. And they always kiss the guy's ass a little bit.
Just so no one calls and complains, it was because one of the kids lied and said he had cancer and sent Joe a card, and then Joe came out. Not because of the dad.
Okay, but that... He's the world's greatest engineer, isn't he? And would you like to shoot holes in my comedy, or should I kind of keep going? But explain Don Drysdale, you jackass. How dare you?
Jon Stenerud.
That's true.
And I know Davy Jones was, Marcia got him. The point is that Joe doesn't make the rounds that way, as great a guy as he is. And neither does Eric and Dain. Your team, your JV volleyball team up north is in a little bit of a slump. They could give a rat's ass.
No, well, actually, we sometimes get
out there.
No, honestly, we get out there to a lot of different schools and different things. But if we're in the area, but
no.
Right now, San Francisco's not on the schedule.
Hey, Dan,
start practicing a little harder, Dan. Maybe get your team to go another extra hour, put in the groundwork, and I'm sure you guys will do better.
Dan, you want to know how to get it on the schedule?
Yeah.
Pass the hat, brother. Let's get some money going.
Okay.
Show a little green there.
I'll do that.
Maybe they'll work you into the schedule.
Nice. I think you need to be our agent, huh?
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't think anyone's going to call.
And then, hey, Dan, what happens if these guys come out, they give you guys a big pep talk, right? You start cleaning up around the league, and one of the other teams goes into a slump. Do they got to come out and help that team now? You understand the implications here,
yeah,
Dan.
Yeah,
it keeps going and going.
All right.
You guys don't play beach volleyball, do you?
No. Oh, we're trying.
San Francisco.
We're more of indoor.
Yeah, you're playing indoor.
Yeah.
All right, start practicing harder.
All right.
Okay. I mean, Drew.
Yeah.
When you were in high school,
yeah.
And you're, let's see, you had an 8-man football team, so your 3.5-man volleyball team went into a slump.
We had a co-ed volleyball team.
Oh, my God. Your volleyball team went in a slump. You didn't have some big-name gold medalist swing by and give you a pep talk, did you?
I remember my self-esteem then. It didn't even occur. Are you kidding?
Yeah.
That would occur to me?
All right. Where the hell were we? Kim.
Hey.
Hey, you're 16. What's going on?
Not much. I cannot believe I got on. Oh, my God.
Great.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So, so anyway, I'm having these dreams, like, where I'm having sex with really hot guys.
I think Sandy Koufax came by the team, too. I can't remember.
The Brady team?
Yeah. I have to look into
it. Whatever happened to Saved by the Bell? Where'd it go?
It went to college and then went to hell.
Oh.
So what's up?
So I just don't know if it's normal. I mean, I don't know.
What, to have sex dreams?
Yeah.
That would be normal.
That's fine.
Really?
Men have those and
sort of women
come out of them when they do it.
They're a little bit...
Like, the guys are really old, too. Like, they're not really old, but like 20s.
Yeah, it's great.
I think Brad Pitt was my first.
Brad Pitt?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Really old.
Yeah.
Yeah. He just had hip replacement surgery. I read in the Inquirer. He's way up there. He has adult children, I believe, now, doesn't he? Hey, Kim?
Yeah.
Now, who cares?
Well, no, wait. She doesn't understand this stuff. She's having an experience. It seems funny to her.
What the?
Yeah, come on. Hey. Come on.
When you're 16, you're having dreams about cute guys. What the hell? Of course.
It's a good thing.
Sex? I mean, come on. That's just a little much for me, personally.
Right.
That's your brain and your body sort of going in the direction it would naturally go if
So you want to? Well, why don't
if
you?
There
go,
were no implications.
Why don't you
behaviors?
Date the guy during the week and then you have sex on the weekends when you dream
done
about
that
him?
With like any guys, I'm at zero base. I go to all girls school.
Ooh.
I don't know.
What's
I'm
up?
Really picky too when it comes to guys.
Yeah. Good. Keep this up.
Apparently they're picky too.
I have a picky problem.
You do?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But maybe she needs
I
to be sort of.
I don't know my dad, so like.
You what?
I don't know my dad.
Uh oh.
Yeah.
So I don't know if that has anything to do with it.
Why don't you know him?
Huh?
You don't know your dad?
Huh? My mom's gay, so I never met him.
Your mom's gay?
Yeah.
Where are you calling from?
Oakland.
What a shocking surprise. She's up in the Bay Area, everybody. How did your mom become pregnant if she's into the ladies?
Because she was, just a friend of his, and she wanted to have a child, so.
he was the sperm donor.
A friend's sperm donor.
Right. You could say. So, this is actually interesting. So you had two moms or just a single mom?
Just a single mom.
So she didn't have a partner during all this?
She has, but then her partner turned out to be an alcoholic, so then she left her.
Were you close to the person at all?
Not really.
Was that their sort of plan? They were going to have a family together, you be the child?
Kind of, yeah.
Didn't that hurt you to lose that other person?
Well, I was young, so.
How old?
Maybe like 7, and then she was with this other woman. And then another woman, and now she's single. So.
Okay, now wait a minute. Hold on a second. Why? So you're saying if two moms is better than one mom, then is three moms better than two moms?
No, what I'm saying is there's
how many moms you need?
Nobody knows yet.
Oh, nobody knows. I know, and God knows.
Gay couples and how that's going to work out, how to do that in a healthy way.
That's more screwed up, kids.
But I would think if this kind of situation, a lot of chaos and people coming in and out of her life would be very impactful on her.
Well, listen.
Negatively.
I don't believe. First off, which one's playing Papa? Do they flip a coin?
Or? Strangely, it's very difficult for that to be played by a woman. It looks like. I mean, just
the dad role.
Yeah, if you look at sort of data, the whole
right.
issue of containing aggression seems to need. That's what I was going to question. How did she? But she's a female. I mean, to a young male.
Right,
it might
so
be
I'm saying,
thing.
What do you need two of them for? You already got one crazy mom.
But she surely was attached to that woman.
I don't know, Kim.
Yeah.
Were you attached to
No.
No, you didn't care.
I don't have a chaotic life, though. I have a really good life, and I do good in school.
No, you sound fine. No, listen, I'm not. I'm just that's why I chose to kind of get into it with you. I want to learn something.
And what do you think? Okay. Do you like guys?
Yeah, totally.
You're not into the lesbian stuff?
No.
Was it weird growing up with a lesbian mom?
Sometimes, because, you know, kids can be really mean, and jokes are always hurtful. So.
But believe me, I know. I got a Brillo head. That's worse than a lesbian mom. Every day is open house when you have a Brillo head. Do you understand that? It's open season.
Can you share with your mom about things like this, about your sexuality, or is it awkward for you?
No, we have a pretty good relationship.
I mean, this is not something
What'd she do, just because it'll be funny?
For a living?
Yeah. She's like a rodeo circuit, or what'd she do?
Oh, she's a, she paints the Bay Bridge.
She paints the bridge.
Yeah.
Oh, that is excellent. Excellent. And she gets to one side. It's time to turn around and come back, right?
Yeah.
She just paints it?
No, it takes 20 years to paint the whole bridge.
Wow.
So by the time, they're done with whatever side, they got to start all over again.
Is that what you just said? Yeah.
I think I may have touched on that. Yeah, about 10 minutes ago. I'm not sure. All right. Well, Kim, you're obviously doing well in school.
Yeah.
You go to the all-girls school.
Yeah. Sounds like you're doing great.
Your mom must love picking you up.
Yeah.
That's great. Look at that.
Oh, please.
Oh, yeah. Come on, kids. She drives the ice cream truck up there. Get in, kids.
It's like you liking to go to an all-girls school.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
That's what I'm saying.
All right.
Same thing.
Kim, you're great. You're fine.
You're
okay?
Beautiful, baby.
True.
Yeah.
What are you doing in San Francisco tomorrow?
Uh-oh. I'm going to a board review for addiction medicine.
You want him to talk to the volleyball team?
Sure.
I'll be broadcasting from Live 105.
Congratulations. I play varsity volleyball, too. And our team is doing horrible, but I'm not going to ask you for help.
That's great, Kim. All right, baby.
Take care.
Thank you.
All right.
Love you.
Love you, baby. That's got to be a great gig, painting that Bay Bridge. Guess what we're doing today, everybody? Yeah? That's right.
What color?
Get the rollers out. I'm going with the primer orange. What do you say? All right.
Oh, the Bay Bridge.
What color is the Bay Bridge? Is it blue?
Isn't it? Like a gray-blue kind of?
The Golden Gate Bridge is that primer orange, yeah. And the Bay Bridge is like gray?
Like a blue-gray, yeah. Grayish.
I wonder if the guys on the Bay Bridge get made fun of by the guys who paint the Golden Gate, you know?
There's like they must bigotry.
Call them, yeah, they must call them something. Oh, what a gig. Just go from one end to the other, and when you get to the end, it's time to come back. I mean, really, you might as well just be a mule working a grindstone. Just crushing something. But, you know, it's all full of benefits. And by the way, here's the other thing. Takes 20 years to paint a bridge. They sub that job out to a couple of non-city employees. I bet you half the amount of men paint it in two years.
Oh.
Maybe one. Is that what you're saying, Drew?
I didn't say anything.
You know those guys.
But maybe it doesn't, you know.
They move a foot a month. All right. We'll take ourselves a little break. Dain and Eric are both here. Sporting the gold. And we'll be back after that. It's Loveline. Phone number. Forget about that. John Crow being here tomorrow night. It's Dr. Roman Carolla, Dain Blanton, and Eric Fonoimoana is in here tonight. These guys have their gold medals, but that pales in comparison to the Billboard syndicated show of the year. 2 years running now, Drew. Is that right?
Yeah.
We have ourselves, you don't believe us? We got, Ann has 50 cents worth of Lucite on her desk that'll back up that statement. I don't know who decided, you know, I've complained about this for some years now. Somebody decided in 1987 that all awards from this day forth will be made out of Lucite.
Yeah.
And to me, I'm over it. I'd like to get back to
cut glass.
I'd like crystal. To see... No, I'd like to see an award. I'd like to see like a trophy.
Oh.
I'd see a guy on top. Like, I'd see a muscle-bound guy holding a microphone over his head.
A wreath in one hand.
Wreath in one hand. Maybe maybe an Arbitron rating book in one hand and like a microphone in the other. A big sort of Roman-esque looking guy. Not something that looks like a paperweight. Something you could kill somebody with. Something you could club somebody with.
Some medals.
Medals, trophies. Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Something I could mount on the hood of the car like an ornament, drive around town with. But anyway, syndicated show of the year. Is that right?
Yep.
Yeah, fantastic. All right, so not feeling so high and mighty with those. Let me tell you something. Gold Olympic medals, they come and go. But Billboard syndicated show of the year, that's forever. You can never take that away. You never take that away. These can be taken away.
Watch.
Drew, start a fire. I'm going to take these things away. Drew just took it away. See, gone. Do you have Drew's Billboard syndicated show of the year award? No, you don't. Because it can't be taken away. No, you can't take it. It's in his heart, man. See, that's the thing. You can't touch it. Where it is, you can't touch. You see?
I just figured out I've been shooting for the wrong day.
Yeah. All those days of practice out in the hot sun and the sand burning the feet and the chafing in the crotch, all for naught. You should have been behind a microphone. Chris?
Hello?
You're 16?
Yeah.
What's up?
I was playing in a football game for my high school on Saturday night. Mm-hmm. And, I was wearing a cup. And on the previous play, the cup kind of came loose. Not like came loose, but it got out of position.
Right.
So it was like kind of on my ball sack. Mm-hmm. And on the next sack, play, I got hit there.
Ooh.
Ouch!
Mm-hmm. And it really hurt.
Yeah, no kidding.
But on that play, like, it's kind of, I didn't go out or anything because even though it hurt, I just kind of stayed in.
Right.
And I played the rest of the game and stuff, and I was all right. But then next day, it hurt so bad.
Did it swell?
I don't know, sort of. Yeah.
Why didn't you have a doctor take a look at it?
Well, I was wondering, like, should I go take...
Yes, yes.
What could be wrong with it? Like?
Well, they can fracture. You can actually fracture the testes. They can be contused. They can break. Supply can be cut off.
How's it looking now?
It looks all right, but it hurts to do anything. Like, I have to wear, like, tidy whities to school because, like, if it's like hanging, it hurts.
That may be all you have to do.
I wear those.
A urologist should take a look at it. Urologist, okay?
A neurologist?
Urologist. U R O. Urologist.
Urologist?
Yes. You need to speak to your Ologist. Do you understand?
Okay.
All right.
All right, and
all right.
Congratulations to the gold medal winners.
Yeah. Hey, what about the coveted Billboard syndicated show of the year?
Whatever.
It's real lucite, baby. Yeah, yeah, well, you see right through it.
There's an old miner.
What's that?
Up in San Joaquin Valley to pull the lucite right out of the ground for that.
That's right. That's right. We, what was I going to say? Oh, you know, one thing I was kind of interested, I went to the Raiders training camp, as you know, some months back, the little man show bit. And, you know, those professional football players, most of them don't wear any pads anymore.
What?
In their pants.
What?
Watch football games.
The thigh pads and stuff?
A lot of them don't wear thigh pads. A lot of them. No knee pads on most of them. Like your average NFL wide receiver, no thigh pads, no knee pads, no cup, no hip pads, and no butt pad.
That's where they're getting nailed, too.
They don't wear most of these guys. And take a look at your average game. You'll see some guys with some pads in their pants, but you'll see a lot of guys with nothing. So essentially, they're playing football, and it's sort of equivalent to a pair of shorts. I mean, a pair of like tight, you know, knickers, basically. I mean, zero. Start looking.
Is this just so they can get an edge on the speed and the acrobatics and stuff? That must be. Yes.
Well, okay. As far as the wideouts go, you know, a knee pad in the NFL is about a quarter inch of foam rubber.
What the hell is that?
And that's not going to torn ACL is not going to be prevented by that. That's going to prevent a scrape.
Yeah, yeah.
So they wear, you know, socks or whatever. They don't care about scrapes. So the knee pad's gone.
Right.
The thigh pad on the wideouts, they don't want to slow it down.
Yeah.
The cup, I can't figure out.
Oof.
And the butt pad, they never really did wear in the NFL. And they used to wear hip pads, but they don't wear those anymore either. So essentially, you're essentially wearing nothing from the waist down.
Wow.
And then some of these guys have these miniature shoulder pads on, these like linemen and stuff, so they don't get hooked, especially like defensive linemen. They don't want to get hooked up on the offensive linemen, so they wear sort of streamlined ones. And it's basically like a helmet and a small pair of shoulder pads.
Wow.
And they're going at it.
Huh.
It's crazy. But on the other hand, you've seen the thighs on a 300-pound man? That's a lot of thigh.
That's true.
You seen like Warren Sapp's ass? Have you seen his ass and thigh?
Not lately.
You know what your thigh? You know, for you to be like 6 foot and 300 pounds, you know how big your thighs are?
Big.
Yeah. You think a pad's gonna
make a difference?
No. No. You know how far you got to get before you get to bone?
12 inches.
Easily.
Yeah.
He is. You got to go through. You got to go through his mom's house to get to that bone. I played football with this Chinese dude named Chunghwa Kim.
You always talked about the Samoan guys.
Kim. No. This guy was Chinese.
Chow. Ding dong day.
See, Chunghwa Kim. See, it was easy. We know.
He was Korean.
Kim. Oh, it was Korean. Yeah, maybe it was.
Yeah.
Maybe it was. Yeah, Chunghwa?
Korean? Kim.
Kim's Korean?
Yeah.
Kim's not Chinese. Oh, who the hell knows?
That's Minka.
This guy was scary. That's all I'm telling you. And this guy's calves were so big. It's the biggest calves I've ever seen in my life. Chunghwa wore the thigh pad on his shin in his sock, and it fit. You know what I'm talking about? You know what an NFL thigh pad looks like? He had it stuffed down the front of his sock, and it worked. I mean, it was there. He had calf hanging out on each side of it, on the back part of it. Chunghwa. And he didn't speak any English, as Chunghwa. There's about that much English, Chunghwa. And he was this crazy guy. He used to break karate chop bricks and stuff. He's a crazy guy. And we'd be doing these drills, you know. And
he was seven?
Chunghwa?
Yeah.
No, how dare you. Chunghwa was, he was like
14.
No, in high school, he was 17 years old. Right. And Chunghwa was on the team because he was 300 pounds. His calves were, you know, big as the field. And I remember once we were lining up in front of him, and the coach was just kind of talking. He's like, all right, we're going to do some technique drills here. Half speed, everybody, half speed. All right, get down in your stance. And I was looking at Chunghwa, and I was going, that whole half speed part, that don't mean nothing to Chung. That didn't process that at all. I stopped there once and said, hold on a second, coach. Chunghwa, the half speed, do you understand that? Okay, listen, coach, I'm not a pussy, but let's just make sure Chunghwa understands the whole half speed things. with the calf, he had the thigh pads in his calves, Drew.
Yeah, you're not a pussy. Come on, don't be such a pussy.
Josh?
Yeah.
Josh, 17, what's up?
Well, I have a little story.
Yeah.
My girlfriend, she's 16. Well, about 6 months ago, I found out she was pregnant. And about, I don't know, about 2 weeks ago, we went to the doctor. And he said everything's fine. We never believed a word he was saying, so we went to a different one.
Yeah, I know those doctors.
Why didn't you believe anything he was saying?
Well, it's a doctor.
Because everything he kept on saying sounded like bullcrap, like all this, like, oh, yeah, she's going to have the baby any time now. And so we went to a different doctor, and the baby's dead inside of her. And they won't touch her because she's a minor. But I'm just wondering, will this hurt her or do anything to her?
Well, the baby will come out.
Don't you abort?
Yeah.
I mean, hold on a second. Don't you sort of spontaneously abort if your child is dead? I mean, how long can you carry something around? Or
but
can
now,
you?
Wait a minute. What?
It's just floating around in her stomach.
In
her uterus or whatever that is.
I don't understand.
Listen, I think it's a stomach temperature.
How did they document that the child was dead?
Because there is no more movement.
They didn't do an ultrasound?
I don't know. They wouldn't let me go with her when I went.
Hold on a second. I got to talk about it. Josh is either like stupid or angry or both or something. Something's up. I don't know why he went to the first doctor and the guy said everything's fine and they didn't believe him.
Yeah.
What was up with that? All right.
That's bizarre.
Hey, Josh, what was up with the first doctor?
What do you mean?
Why wouldn't you believe him if he said everything was fine?
Because she just felt weird about the baby inside. She wasn't feeling any more kicking or...
So she had been a while since she'd felt... And how far along was she?
6 months.
6 months.
The baby's due... It was due January 6th.
So now they went... You went to the second doctor, and they probably did some kind of ultrasound?
And they what?
Okay.
Mm.
And,
Well, the other doctor wouldn't let me go in because I don't know why he said something to her parents about some kind of legal stuff.
All right. And
yeah,
so
he probably sized you up.
And so
the torn parka with the duct tape on it and the painter's hat on backwards and the bad teenage mustache and said, why don't you wait out in the hall?
And a few piercings. And if the parents were there, why didn't they get consent to do something?
Because she's a minor.
Yeah, but the parents were there.
Yeah, remember the consent part? The consent. Her parents could have said, fine, do. Give her an abortion. Well,
there's another appointment on Friday that they're going to.
All right.
I just wanted to know if this can hurt her.
No, it's fine. Listen, Josh, you don't trust anybody. These people are trying to take care of her, okay? They have a fiduciary and professional responsibility to do what is best for her, period.
Yeah, but it was good going to the new doctor because he told her what was wrong. The other one wouldn't tell her. He kept telling her.
Okay, okay. You want to revisit that again? Hey, Josh, why you sound angry? Are you angry? You're an angry person?
Not really.
No? Okay. How are you doing?
Pretty good.
All right. You in school?
Yeah, I've just been worried about her.
Okay. And maybe, you know, aren't you a little young to be starting a family?
Well, the condom broke.
I see. All right. Well, can you be... Okay, she'll...
Morning after pill next time.
She'll be fine, but you don't have any more kids for a while, all right, Josh?
Okay.
All right. Take care.
Oh, boy.
Listen. I know this sounds like the worst thing in the world, but this kid just dodged a bullet. They really did. And Josh, I imagine Josh's papa, that pissed off teenage Josh taking care of you. Oh, I can't. See, here's the whole thing. When you're a kid, here's the deal. And I know we've gotten into this before, and it makes everyone hate me. But as a kid, from zero to whatever... Now, we look at Josh as a teenage screwball, right?
Mm-hmm.
They look at Josh as the God, the Messiah, the light, the provider, everything. He's everything.
The child, born
the child
to Josh,
looks born to at Josh as everything.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
That's the scary part.
Yeah. That becomes the measure of all that is good.
Right. Okay, Josh, listen, I don't want to come in on you too hard. It's just there's something... strange about your voice, but I'm sorry for what's happened to your girlfriend. Ultimately, I think it's a good thing. You guys can wait a little while, another 2 or 3 months, and start a family. We'll take a break. It's Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. It's Dr. Drew. Dain and Eric are both here. Olympic volleyball gold medalists, everybody. And just the two of them. They don't have to share it with that whole team. like the indoor guys. Indoor guys, so big deal. You and 28 guys got a gold pig. That's not a... Yeah, you rode the pine the whole time. Come on. You don't have that. Not these guys. No excuses. That's it. Just the two of them out there. How long does the average game last? I know it matters. It depends on, you know, how close it is. But what are you usually out there
about
for?
About 45 minutes. I mean, some will go longer than that. We've played matches an hour and 20 minutes. I mean, it all depends. But I've seen games go 20 minutes or 15, 20 minutes when you just kill a team. And then if you get a real good matchup, you can go as long as an hour or more.
The whole, even the serve thing is freaky to me. You see those guys that get way back there, get that run, get that jump. No more, you guys don't go underhandies anymore?
No, the sky ball is off limits nowadays.
Oh, where they used to just hit that colossal
as they could.
Arc shot, and you just have to wait for it to come down?
Yeah.
Is that, do they, could you do it?
Yeah, you can do it anytime you want to.
It's not going
to
work, though?
No.
The
quick points are, you know, we serve pretty fast, so.
And you guys put some English on it on that, right? I mean, that ball will curve when it's coming in.
Yeah, a lot of those, I mean, everybody jumps serves these days.
Right.
It's rare that you see a sky ball or something, but if the sun's in the right position or...
Oh, they try to put it in the sun.
Right, or if it's a little windy. There's just so many elements out on the court when you're playing.
Sure.
And that's why we switch in increments of 5 points. But most people are jump serving and trying to score right off the serve, similar to like tennis now. You know,
right.
There's those big bombers and a lot of points can be scored right off the serve.
You ever have a seagull crap on you?
No, I've had birds fly across the
really?
Court right in the middle of the
seemed
game.
Seemed like something happened every 10 minutes out there. True, you ever get crapped on by seagull?
Not while playing volleyball.
I see. But when you're doing what? On the rings? Down at Muscle Beach? I like those guys. You know, guys, volleyball's fine. It's a sport you're playing. I don't like the guys who work out in full view of everyone. You ever see those guys down at the park doing Tai Chi? They spread their blanket out in the middle of everyone. They take their shirts off, and they start going through this kung fu crap in front of everyone. It's like, oh, listen, buddy, go to the Red Onion if you want to get laid. Get off the beach. The guys actually treat the park and the beach like it's their gym. They're doing push-ups and shadow boxing and running in plays. I mean, come on. You throw the frisbee, that's fine. But I don't want to be playing softball while you're in some kind of lotus position burning some incense out in center field. What is that? That's got to be an attention thing. What about the guys who sun themselves at the park?
What about our callers? Come on.
You know what I'm talking about?
Come on.
These guys get out there in a speedo and they spread their towel out in the middle of the park and they start sunning themselves.
Dain does that actually a couple times. I've seen him.
Dain, you do that?
Yeah, to warm up.
You sun yourself?
Yeah.
No, I actually do the Tai Chi.
Oh, you do not. Does he do Tai Chi?
No.
Good, thank God. Garrett?
Hello?
You're 29.
Yes, I am.
Yeah, it's great. Yeah, Tai Chi's great. It's self-defense in ultra-slow motion.
Everyone is kung fu fighting there.
What's your question, Garrett?
Well, Dain and Eric, for both of you, I read in a magazine, I think it was Newsweek, I heard that you guys are so big in Europe right now that when you guys are playing on feature court, women are actually tearing off their bikini bottoms and throwing them on the court for you to pick up. Is this true?
Where'd you read that, man? Choir?
No. That was Newsweek.
Newsweek. Wow.
No, we do play on some topless beaches, but we've
I
never...
I heard you guys are blowing up.
Yeah, it's big. I've never had a girl take their bottoms off, though.
Your top, maybe? Her top?
Their top, yeah.
Really?
Definitely.
You treat yourself?
Hey, Garrett, what do you want, a pimp?
Well, you know,
you want me to hook you up or what?
These guys are living large right now.
I know, but what's that have to do with you? I'm not getting
no,
any.
I read the article. I was really excited for him. I'm a big fan of volleyball, so I just wanted to ask him that question, but thank you very much.
All right, Garrett.
All right, have a good evening.
Thanks.
You're gay.
Throwing the bottoms off.
He probably read that. It was his own little twist on the interpretation that he read right. That bathing suits were thrown at
right.
them.
Right.
In Europe, he made them topless.
He did the math.
He made them topless
right.
beaches.
Well, he did process of elimination. Well, if they're at a topless
they're
beach
Europe,
and they're throwing their
topless,
bathing suits,
yeah.
It's got to be their shorts.
Yeah.
Interesting. And if it's an all-nude beach, they throw tampons, right?
Oh, come on.
Guy. Right. Hey, it's getting late.
It's getting really
last
late.
Call.
Oh, they
go.
Got to throw something is what I'm saying. Drew, what are you getting paid by the call tonight?
I'm going to get these two.
Are you doing piecework?
Look at this one. Come
relax
on.
Over there. Phil?
Yeah.
You're 21.
Yeah, I'm here.
What's up?
This question is for Eric. I got a question about your charity, Digs for Kids. Are you going to return back to your coaching days at MiraCosta and promote Digs Through Kids through coaching indoor volleyball there at MiraCosta with Cooker?
I still help out at Costa. I always help out with them, but it's just an extension of my coaching.
Yeah, because I was a formal pupil there, and I was just wondering if you're going to return to the glory days.
Did you play for the team?
Yeah, well, you were. You did coach me in the 98 team.
Ah.
Do you remember? You must have been outstanding, Phil, because Eric's lit up.
Oh, no. He just made me run a couple line drills and do a couple balls for him. But is that going to be an extension of your Digs for Kids program?
Yeah, it's just Costa helped me out as far as learning how to coach and get a philosophy down. But, you know, again, I've always given back to something that's always given back so much to me.
Yeah. All right. Like start your grassroots.
Eric, hold on. Shut up, Phil. Do you remember Phil?
Phil? You know, I haven't.
Isaac.
Phil Isaac, yeah, I do remember Phil Isaac. He has dark hair, little guy, a lot of fire.
Troublemaker.
Troublemaker.
He had a lot of his classic. He was good to coach, actually. He was entertainment value, which is very important as a coach.
He obviously has a lot of personality. I'm guessing Gemini.
That's why the coaches liked you, Adam.
I was just curious.
All right.
I'm up here at UCSB.
He's in the vortex.
See ya.
Bye.
You'll never come back. You'll open a bong shop in Isla Vista, and that'll be it.
Cool.
Fine, though. It's a good life. Yeah.
I like it.
You go up to, I'll never let my kids go to Santa Barbara to go to school.
Eric went to
And never come back.
Yeah.
Never come back.
Santa Barbara. Look at you now.
Oh, you don't even have a real job. We'll take ourselves a break. We'll be back. All right. Well, wait a minute. Now, Dain wanted to talk to poor Jeff real fast. Hey, Jeff.
Yeah?
Okay. We're out of show. I know you've been on hold for 64 minutes. I apologize. But it gives you character. Okay?
Yeah.
You can borrow my medal in that break.
You want to borrow Dane's medal?
No, that's all right.
All right, buddy.
All right.
Sorry.
Can help.
Sorry about that, Jeff. Is that cool?
Yeah, that's okay.
All right, buddy. You get some sleep, okay?
Okay.
All right. All right, DaneBlanton.com is where you can find Dane stuff, and digforkids.com is where you can find Eric stuff. Thanks a lot, guys. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
And if you win another gold, you come back on the show. Otherwise, that's it.
It's over.
So until next time, Sam Kroll for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
Oh, boy. This is